Hello, welcome to La Excellence. In our recap program, we are discussing monthly current affairs videos. In this video, let us discuss May 2021 related issues. For other months, notes is ready, so we will be uploading the videos very quickly. Yes, this is part 2 of May 2021. You can download the notes by clicking on the link given below. If you want to write test series based on monthly current affairs videos, you can join the test by clicking on the link in the description. Right. Let us discuss governance related aspects. First issue is Ayushman Bharat and the National Health Authority. Ayushman Bharat is a flagship program of Government of India, which provides care for primary, tertiary and secondary. Under Ayushman Bharat, we have two components. One is Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. Second one is primary healthcare centers. These primary healthcare centers, PHCs, health and wellness centers, these are known as health and wellness centers. These health and wellness centers, they deal with primary healthcare. Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, it deals with secondary and tertiary healthcare services. With regard to Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, it's an insurance program. That means it provides insurance coverage of 5 lakh rupees per family per year for secondary and tertiary care hospitals in both public and private hospitals. These are the eligibility conditions to gain access to this insurance. Overall, 10.74 crore families, that means approximately 50 crore beneficiaries are eligible under this scheme. It is implemented by National Health Authority. National Health Authority is also nodal agency for implementing National Digital Health Mission. Next issue is safe harbor protection. In the last month's current issues, we have discussed about IT rules 2021, what are the issues under it, what are the guidelines given by the government. Under new IT guidelines, if any intermediary or social media company, if not complying with these rules, then safe harbor protection provided under IT Act, that is Section 79 of IT Act, it provides safe harbor protection. That means intermediaries are protected from posting the information. Let's say A posted the information in Twitter, which B has read and B complained. But this case won't be on this intermediary, this case will be on this individual. That means intermediary's responsibility is not fixed over here. That is safe harbor protection. It is safe. That safe harbor protection will be removed if the social media company or intermediary is not complying with the new IT guidelines. Next issue is midday meal scheme. Recently, because of COVID-19, especially during the second wave, many school children didn't get the midday benefits under midday meal scheme. So that is why how to provide the alternative nutritional and food facilities during the lockdown, that was the question discussed at the time. That's why it was news. Midday meal scheme, it guarantees one meal of as of now cooked meal to all children of government aided schools and madrasa schools under Samagra Siksha Abhiyan, important. And it is provided till 8th class. This program was launched in 1995 as National Program of Nutritional Supply to Primary Education. Then its name was changed to Midday Meal Scheme. This scheme is covered under National Food Security Act. You have to go through the nutritional norms, important. Because nutritional levels are going down, if you observe the Global Hunger Index, etc. In this context, what are the nutritional norms under Midday Meal Scheme, under Poshan Abhiyan, important andi. Under Poshan Abhiyan and under Midday Meal Scheme, what are the nutritional norms? Just go through this list once. And according to these rules, MDM, Midday Meal 2015 rules, every children should be served with the cooked meals at the school only. If meal is not delivered, they'll be provided with food security allowance. School management committees under RTE, Right to Education, should play a proactive role in implementation of this scheme. Next issue is MP LADS scheme. MP LAD is a central sector scheme, that means 100% fund provided by the center, central sector scheme, under which each MP will be given 5 crore rupees in 2 installments. And this scheme is monitored under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Here the important point that we have to remember is how an MP participates in this particular scheme. MP recommends the work in the constituency and district authorities they authorize. MASP releases the money not to the MP, to the district authority. And we can get to know the information on what works are selected, what is the implementing authority, when it will be completed. All these things can be known by filing RTI. MP LADS scheme, recently it was, last year it was suspended for 2 years, that's why it was in news. Lok Sabha MP recommends the works in his or her constituency. Rajya Sabha MP can recommend the works in any constituency from the state from which he is represented. Nominated MPs can recommend the works anywhere in the country. Next issue is Central Adoption Resources Authority, CARA. Recently, Supreme Court has directed various states and union territories to take proper measures to protect the children from trafficking, especially COVID orphans. In this context, all the adoptions are through CARA only. What is this CARA? CARA is a statutory body under Ministry of Women and Child Welfare. It functions as the nodal body for adoption of Indian children, both for in-country adoption and inter-country adoption. Inter-country means an American can adopt Indian child. CARA is designated as the central authority under Hague Convention on Inter-Country Authority. India ratified this particular convention. This deals with our adoption of orphans, abandoned and surrendered children through its associated agencies. And it is mandated to implement the regulations under Juvenile Justice Act, JJA. JJA, for this also nodal agency is Central Adoption Resources Authority. Next issue is Samudra Setu 2. Samudra Setu 2 as a project was launched in the last year. And it is to repatriate the Indians who were stranded in other countries. It is launched by Indian Navy. This year, Samudra Setu 2 was launched for the shipment of oxygen-filled cryogenic tankers to India. Under Operation Samudra Setu, seven naval ships participated. All these transported cryogenic containers and associated medical equipments from various countries to India. Under Operation Samudra Setu 2, Operation Samudra Setu 1 is for repatriation. Next issue is PVTGs, particularly vulnerable tribal groups. It was said that vaccine hesitancy among the particular vulnerable groups make them much vulnerable because their population is already less. So in this context, vaccine hesitancy needs to be addressed in these areas. Especially this was the issue in news because Bonda tribe is one of the PVTG tribe located in Odisha region. So among Bonda tribe, vaccine hesitancy was more at the time. That's why it was in news. Who are PVTGs? Particularly vulnerable tribal groups are more vulnerable among the existing tribal groups. They generally, these are the criteria to determine PVTG status. A pre-agricultural level of technology, stagnant and declining population, extremely low literacy, subsistence level of economy. In 1973, Deber Commission has said that among the tribal groups, primitive tribal groups needs to be a separate category. In the year 2006, we named it as particularly vulnerable tribal groups, replacing PTG, primitive tribal groups. There are 75 listed particularly vulnerable tribal groups. Among them, highest number is found in Odisha, followed by Andhra Pradesh. Next, let us discuss environment and disaster management related issues. Next issue is State Disaster Response Fund. Here, we have to clearly revise National Disaster Management Act. This year, it is very, very important. National Disaster Management Act or Disaster Management Act 2005. Under this act, there are two funds at the state level, two funds at the central level. At the state level, we have State Disaster Response Fund, and at the similarly, we have State Disaster Mitigation Fund. State Disaster Response Fund, State Disaster Mitigation Fund. Similarly, at the national level, we have National Disaster Response Fund, National Disaster Mitigation Fund. Now, let us discuss State Disaster Response Fund. Under Disaster Management Act, it is placed under State Executive Committee. National Disaster Response Fund, is placed under State Executive Committee. This SDRF is constituted under 2005 Act based on the recommendations of 13th Finance Commission. Every year, CAG audits this fund. From the center, into this fund, center contributes 75% and states contribute 25%. In special category states, 90% is contributed by the center, 10% is by the states. Annual central contributions is released in two equal installments based on Finance Commission's recommendations. What are the disasters covered under State Disaster Response Fund? Drought, cyclone, earthquake, fire, flood, tsunami, hailstorm, landslides, avalanche, cloudburst, pest attack, frost and cold waves. COVID is not there. That is, biological disasters are not covered under this. But still, under local disasters category, this is covered. But we know this is not a local hazard. This is a national hazard. So as this is the national disaster, funds from the National Disaster Response Fund and funds from, say, State Disaster Response Fund, both were used to fight with COVID-19. Next issue is National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being. Government of India has recently launched this program, that is why it's in news. What is this National Mission on Biodiversity? Under this mission, it clearly delineates that under this, human health is closely interrelated with animal health as well as the environment. To recognize that and to implement this, we have this mission known as National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being. This theme is known as One Health Program. This One Health concept is effective in fighting the zoonotic diseases. There are many diseases that are originated and spread to humans from the animals. Such diseases are known as zoonotic diseases. In March 2021, monthly revision video, we have discussed about what are these zoonotic diseases, how do they spread, what are the examples. These all things were discussed in that month. Just to go through it once. This One Health concept, it is used by FAO, Food and Agricultural Organization, World Health Organization, World Organization for Animal Health, etc. This is important. This One Health component is important for National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being. Next issue is Project Elephant. Recently, Ministry of Environment and Forests and Climate Change has released the statistics of elephant deaths on railway tracks. In this context, to protect the elephants, we have taken many measures. One important measure is Project Elephant. This was launched in the year 1992 to provide the financial and technical assistance to the states to protect wild Asian elephants. And it's a centrally sponsored scheme, that means center and states both contribute. It is to protect the habitat and elephant corridors, and it is to address the man-animal conflict. It is to provide for welfare of captive animals, captive elephants, let's say for circus, let's say for temples. There are many elephants which are used for. And for welfare of this, Project Elephants deal with certain components. And there are 16 states and union territories in which Project Elephant is implemented. Elephant is declared as the National Heritage Animal in the year 2010. Elephants are considered architect of forests and woodlands. These are known as keystone species of the forest and woodlands. And they also help in pollination and germination of seeds. And they improve the fertility of the soil using the dung. So elephant is an important keystone species. That's why this Project Elephant was launched. We are taking many measures. And in previous month, we have discussed rehab program where bees are used to address the man-animal conflict, especially with regard to elephants. Yes, try to recollect that once. Next issue is Cyclone Tate and Cyclone Yaas. These are the two cyclones that were formed over Bay of Bengal region and Arabian region. Now, in this context, let us discuss what is a cyclone, how are they formed, what are the conditions for formation of cyclone, how cyclones are named, etc. Cyclone is low pressure system. It carries heavy winds and heavy rains with it. Cyclones are classified into extratropical cyclones and tropical cyclones. As India experiences tropical cyclones, let us discuss that. Cyclones are formed over the water bodies only. Cyclones are formed over water bodies only. Especially tropical cyclones, and one of the primary condition is to have water temperatures till the depth of 60 meters of 26 degrees or more. This forms the clouds and this forms the low pressure system. From the high pressure systems, low pressure system receives the winds. These winds and these clouds, they move in a anti-clockwise direction in the northern hemisphere. Cyclones move in anti-clockwise direction because of the Coriolis force. And in the southern hemisphere, they move in clockwise direction. And they generally move from east to west. They move from east to west. Cyclones move from east to west. And this entire pressure system, this is a cumulonimbus cloud, CV cloud, CV clouds. And this is known as eye of the cyclone. This eye of the cyclone is generally calm, surrounded with huge clouds. And when this reaches the land, it gets cut off with the source of heat. So it leads to landfall. When it goes for landfall, it rains heavily, associated with heavy winds. These are the conditions for formation of tropical cyclone we just now discussed. Presence of Coriolis force is one of the major conditions. In 5 degree north to 5 degree south region, as we don't have the influence of Coriolis force, we don't have cyclones. Cyclones in the equatorial zones are not there because of absence of Coriolis force. These are the other conditions. This is very, very important, and many times this question was asked in prelims. Just go through this once. And cyclonic storms are divided into different categories based on the wind speeds. And these are the names in which it is called. In Atlantic Ocean, it is called hurricanes. And in Indian Ocean region, cyclones. In Pacific Ocean, typhoons. Here in Australian region, willy willies, tornadoes on land. If it is on land, these are called tornadoes. And we name the cyclones. There is World Meteorological Organization. Under that, we have regional centers. For the Northern Indian Ocean region, our IMD is the nodal center. And these names are given so that it can be remembered simply and they should not be complex. For example, recent Gulab. Gulab is a cyclone which is named by Pakistan. So let us see how countries name them. See, in the Northern Indian Ocean region where we are situated, we have 13 countries impacted by the cyclones from both Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea region. In this context, there are 13 countries. These countries, they give the names. And alphabetically, these countries are located. For example, Tote, Yas. After that, Gulab. Gulab is the name given by Pakistan. Yas given by Oman. Tote given by Myanmar. So next cyclone will be named as Shaheen. Like that, this continues. And then we will come back to this. That is how cyclones are named. Right, cyclones, they move from east to west. Here to here. Here to here. But cyclones also move to this region because of the recurving. This is an important word. Recurving of cyclones, they lead to rainfall in Gujarat and northern part of Maharashtra. Recurving of cyclones leads to rainfall in West Bengal and Bangladesh regions. Tropical cyclones, they form between Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. Next issue is Sundar Lal Bahuguna. Sundar Lal Bahuguna, the famous environmentalist, was died. So that is why it was news. With regard to this, we have to understand what is this CIPCO movement which he has pioneered. CIPCO movement is non-violent agitation which started in Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. Earlier in 1973, that was part of Uttar Pradesh. Now, as Uttar Pradesh and Uttarakhand divided, so it's in Uttarakhand. CIPCO means hugging the tree. So the people in this region, they have fought against, or they fought to protect their forests. So in this context, this is a movement of collective mobilization of people wherein women were participated on a large scale in this movement. Very, very important. This Chamoli district in news because of recent disasters. Next issue is global methane assessment. Methane is a greenhouse gas. Methane gas has high global warming potential. Global warming potential means compared to CO2, it can heat up the environment multifold. And it is a short-lived climate pollutant. It lives only for 10 to 15 years. And methane is short-lived. It is, and methane contributes to formation of ground-level ozone. This ground level ozone is one of the sources of respiratory diseases. Now, methane is released during many activities, especially cultivation of rice, etc., and animal husbandry. There is a region called permafrost region in the northern hemisphere as well as in the southern hemisphere. When permafrost melting happens, it gives rise to methane gas. From the marshy lands, methane gas is released. Recently, USA has adopted a resolution to reduce methane gas emissions. Try to recollect that once. Now, so this global methane assessment is published by United Nations Environment Program with Climate Clean Air Coalition. As we discussed, it is a short-lived pollutant. Next is Arctic Science Ministerial. Third Arctic Science Ministerial, which is known as ASM3, was organized collectively by Iceland and Japan. Iceland is an Arctic Circle country, which is part of Arctic Council. There is a grouping known as Arctic Council. All the Arctic Circle countries are part of this Arctic Council. What are these Arctic members? USA, Russia, Finland, Sweden, Norway, Iceland, Denmark and Canada. These are the countries. This Greenland belongs to Denmark, that's why. So these are the countries which are part of Arctic Council. There are other observer countries such as India, Japan, UK, etc. Observer countries are there. So in this context, this Arctic Ministerial Conference was held. This is the third time. Initially in ASM1, ASM2 were held in USA and Germany. This is the first time this Arctic Ministerial Council is held in Asia. Japan means Asia. This Arctic Ministerial Council, it helps in understanding the Arctic region collectively. It emphasizes on constant monitoring and strengthening the observations. This is important for India because we have third pole region. Third pole, Himalayan region is known as third pole region. This third pole region is experiencing high melting of glaciers, etc. In this context, Arctic Ministerial meeting and understanding Arctic region is important. Next issue is Bunny Grassland Reserve. Even in Uttarakhand, this is part of Gujarat. Even in Uttarakhand, traditional communities were restricted in accessing the protected areas and the resources in it. Supreme Court has clearly said that under Forest Rights Act, these traditional communities, they have the community rights over these grasslands. In this context, Bunny area is part of Gujarat region, Kutch region. There is this location known as Kori Creek. This is Greater Run of Kutch. This is Little Run of Kutch. Maldhari community. Maldharis are pastoralists belonging to Gujarat region. This Bunny Grassland Reserve is in Kutch district of Gujarat. This region emerged from the sea as a result of tectonic activity. And Bunny Grassland Reserve area, in this area, Maldhari tribe, they live. Maldhari community is a tribe of herdsmen. They live in settlements called Ness. And they make their living by selling the milk from water buffaloes. Similarly, Wan Gujars are part of Uttarakhand. So these were also restricted the rights in accessing the protected areas such as Govind Pashu Vihar National Park. According to Supreme Court's judgment, they have the right to access. Let us discuss a few points about Wan Gujars. Wan Gujars, they follow seasonal migration patterns in Tarai, Babar and Shivalik region of Uttarakhand. And this is known as transhumans. Humans, they migrate. Along with the animal community, these are pastoralist tribe. Recently, they were not permitted to access the Govind Pashu Vihar National Park, but according to Supreme Court judgment, they have rights under Forest Rights Act. According to Forest Rights Act, pastoralists have the right. Under Section 2A of Forest Rights Act, rights of pastoral community on customary community land is mentioned. That means seasonally they can use the landscape. They can use the landscape even in the unclassified forest, reserved forest, undemarcated forest, deemed forest, protected areas, sanctuaries and national parks too. Next issue is Global Electric Vehicles Initiative. Recently, IAE, that is International Energy Agency and Electric Vehicles Initiative, they have released annual EV outlook, according to which at the end of 2020, worldwide 10 million electric cars were sold. That means overall 2.5% of total car sales. If governments accelerate towards the sustainable development, this EV fleet should increase the market share to 12% from 2.5%. It ensures electricity and energy access to everyone. It leads to a reduction in the emissions. It meets the global climate goals under Paris Agreement. As are known, EVs, if they replace the petrol and diesel based vehicles, it will achieve these three goals. As are known, that should be the goal of it. And India has a scheme known as FAME II. Already we have discussed FAME II. Faster adoption of electric and hybrid vehicles manufacturing scheme. This is FAME II. Next, let us discuss briefly about international relations related current issues. First one is Roadmap 2030 and India-UK. India and UK recently held a bilateral meeting in which they have clearly demarcated the bilateral relationship on this Roadmap 2020. This will elevate the bilateral ties to comprehensive strategic partnership. India and UK are trying to sign free trade agreement. Here we have to remember this. UK after Brexit is forging new relationship with many countries. In this regard, India is one of the important countries with which it is trying to make free trade agreement. According to this, this will expand the India-UK health partnership, international supply chain resilience, and it is to enhance the existing India-UK vaccine partnership. In this context, let us see strategic relationship, especially with regard to bilateral military exercises. Indradhanush is Air Force exercise between India and UK. Konkan is Navy exercise. Army exercises Ajaya Warrior. Ajaya Warrior is with UK. Next issue is Yellow Notice and Interpol. Recently, Yellow Notice is issued by Interpol to track the Mehul Choksi, who is a wanted person under Punjab National Bank fraud. He was last seen in Antigua and Barbuda, which is a Caribbean country. So in this context, let us understand what is this Interpol and what are these yellow notices. Yellow notice is given to identify the missing person. Red notice means wanted person. Blue notice means we want additional information on this person. By the way, what is Interpol? International Police. It's an intergovernmental organization consisting of 194 member countries. Each of the member countries hosts the Interpol National Central Bureau. This CBI in India, Central Bureau of Investigation in India, is the nodal agency that coordinates with Interpol. Its headquarters is located in Lyon, France. Next issue is debt trap diplomacy. China and Sri Lanka's relationship is described as debt trap diplomacy. What is this? China is using financial tool of debt to gain strategic influence over the countries. For example, if you take Sri Lanka, Hambantota, this is a port built by Hambantota. It's at the edge of southern tip of Sri Lanka, Hambantota. This port is built by the China with the funding, Chinese funding. As Sri Lanka is unable to repay it on time, they have taken control over it for many years as a lease. So in this context, this can be called as debt trap diplomacy. Under China's One Belt, One Road initiative, China is criticized to follow this particular diplomatic method to gain control over the countries. Next, let us discuss security related issues. First issue is P-8I deal. P-8I is the patrol aircraft which is built and manufactured in USA. India is the first international customer to import the P-8I aircrafts, and these are used for surveillance purpose. These are used by Indian Navy for surveillance. They can fly almost to 1200 nautical miles without any interruption. They help in long range reconnaissance and anti-submarine warfare. The 6 P-8I deal, this was made, and these aircraft, they come fitted with the encrypted systems. And we have a agreement between India and USA that is known as COMCOSA.
Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement with USA. There are four foundational agreements with USA. We have signed all the four foundational military agreements with USA. LEMOVA, COMCOSA, BECAR, likewise GSMOA. There are four agreements. Last issue in this video is Iron Dome system. Iron Dome is the name of Israel's anti-ballistic missile system. ABSM, anti-ballistic missile system. Let's say here from Palestine, they are launching missiles from here. Radars and other sensors, they detect and they send the signal to control centers. Based on the command of control centers, missile launchers, they launch the missile which will destroy this incoming missile within the air itself, so that damage on the ground would be minimal. Iron Dome system, it consists of short range ground to air missiles, which this is known as air defense system. There are radars and Tamir interceptor missiles. They track and neutralize the missiles and rockets within the air itself. And these are developed by Rafael Advanced Air Defense Systems, and it can provide 90% success rate. In India, we are purchasing S-400 missile defense system, Barak missile systems from Israel. We also have Akash defense system, Prithvi defense system. These are all similar to this. These are the issues of part 2. Thank you very much. All the very best.